Hello, and welcome back to Modern Education. I'm the host of Modern Education, Benjamin S. Woodford, here in the studio one more time. We are in the KZSU studio, sitting directly underneath Memorial Auditorium, right in the center of the Stanford campus. We are on the dial, on the FM dial at 90.1 FM, as well as streaming online at kzsu.stanford.edu/live. You can always call into the show at 855-723-9010, and we would be very happy to get your calls or your texts. Texts usually work best. You can also get us on the Twitter at KZSU, at KZSUDJ. We're always happy to hear from you. This week's show is not live, but each week we generally have a live show coming at you. This week is a pre-recorded show just for scheduling reasons, but we are very, very happy to have you with us this week, and I'm excited to bring my guest this week onto the microphone. This has been an interview I've been waiting for a long time to make happen, and it's finally happening, so I hope you in the audience are just as excited as I am to sit down with us for the next hour, hash out some ideas, and have a discussion about things that affect us within the world of education. Sometimes we seek to educate here on the show. Other times we seek to talk about education. Sometimes we share stories about educators or educated people. And today I think we're going to do a little bit of all of that. So I'm excited to bring my guest on the mic. My guest today is Emily Hahn. She is a almost high school graduate who has been going through quite a bit of interesting stuff, which we're going to hear about really soon. She's also got some notoriety on her own outside of the stories we're going to share today, from being in the voice in Toy Story 3 of, who was that again, Emily?
It was Bonnie, the little girl who gets the toys at the end.
Bonnie from Toy Story 3. This is who Emily played in that movie. She was also in Beautifully Broken. I feel like it was the lead role in Beautifully Broken, right? It was kind of ambiguous because there were a lot of leads
I'd say the lead is played by Benjamin Onyango, and I'm like,
okay.
Maybe,
well, I feel like the whole story centered around you. Yeah, but it was a very interesting movie, too. And also, she's a musician and a writer, and she's a very interesting character in a lot of levels. And I've had the joy of sitting down and talking with her for a while, and I was so inspired by her story that I had to get her on the show to share a bit of this story with the rest of you. So, Emily.
Hello.
Thank you so much for joining me. This has been such a fun time just preparing for this show and getting to know you a little bit. And I'm really excited to be able to share what you came to share with us today, as well as just kind of get to know you a little better.
Oh, well, thank you for having me. Yeah, I'm stoked to be here.
So I want to kind of start. I always like to hear a little bit of people's origin story. And I think it's fun to think about it that way. Now, when we're talking origin story in this context, right, we're talking about kind of your health struggles. And So I think your origin story in this context is really where and how you got this sort of groundwork information you needed to even start the story.
This is
sort of your high school career and your teachers, and like, what were some of your influences that helped you have this can-do attitude that's kind of carried you through this whole process that you've been through?
I think definitely I can trace it back to my parents. I grew up in a medical environment. So my dad was a doctor. He was a family physician, and I grew up rounding with him at, like, you know, the age of 6 or 7. Younger than that.
Did you have a white coat?
You know what? I did.
Really?
I got one for Christmas. It had Emily Hahn on it.
Was it a little white coat?
Yes, it was a very... I know. But growing up in
That's a cool dad.
Oh, seriously.
Yeah.
But growing up in the medical environment just kind of establishes this sense of understanding of the world that's different if you didn't have that.
Yeah.
So I definitely think that's the first initial thing I can trace back to that played such a huge factor.
And was your dad How did your dad help you interact in that space or feel like you belonged there when, like, clearly you were probably the only kid wearing a lab coat with your name on it, right?
Yeah. Well, he would just bring me into whatever he was doing. You know, if it was an ultrasound, I would go in and I would, sometimes he let me actually do the ultrasound.
Whoa.
You know, he would just hand me a medical book and I would read it. And it was interesting and it was fun. And if he had to go deliver a baby, then I would go wait in his office and just play with all his gadgets and toys. And so, he was an inventor as well. So I would see his prototypes and I just, from a very young age, I really loved medicine and medical phenomenons. And for me, it was just like, it was so, I never feared the unknown because his whole life was the unknown. On a day-to-day basis, he dealt with, you know, anything from a crazy delivery case to something simple, like, you know, oh, just an ultrasound. Mm-hmm. But it's just, there was not a lot of, I didn't come from a fear-based standpoint. And so my parents just really, my mom did too. I mean, I was just, from a very young age, I was raised to embrace the unknown.
Wow. Wow. And that's a lucky set of circumstances mm-hmm. that not everybody necessarily has. How do you think that's shaped you as you take on new challenges growing up?
Growing up, it just kind of made me different too, because, like, you know, if somebody on the playground was saying, oh, check out these new Legos, I'd be like, hey, do you know what a hysterectomy is?
Okay. Did that go over well on the playground?
Of course not.
And yet now it totally does. So I guess just,
I wouldn't say that.
You just needed to grow up a little bit.
No. I don't know. I think people are still kind of, they don't really want to converse over stuff like that.
Okay. Fair enough. Maybe not.
But you're cool. Know. You'll talk about hysterectomies, right?
I'll talk about anything. I think conversation should have no boundaries as Agreed. Long as everybody feels respected in the mm-hmm. process, right?
Absolutely.
Okay. So growing up, you were maybe a little more mature in your content than other kids because you'd be
Or just
exposed.
Weird. I mean,
okay, well, yeah,
we can just label it that too.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think if everybody is weird, then there's no such thing as normal. And I think that seems more realistic than
Absolutely.
Everybody's normal and just mm-hmm. a few people are weird. It just doesn't, I don't buy it. Okay. Now, what happened to your dad?
So, he passed away in 2013, I believe.
And how old were you at that time?
I was 12. I was about to turn 13.
Oh, wow. So you still have plenty of memories of your dad and, like,
oh, yeah.
it was vivid for you.
Yeah.
Still,
I mean, he was definitely like my best friend.
Yeah.
And so he died because of a medical error during mm-hmm. a routine. He had a pacemaker because he had heart disease. And so, you know, every 5 years you get your pacemaker replaced. It's a pretty basic procedure.
Yeah.
And because of something that happened during that operation, it permanently left damage, and he lived about 6 weeks after that.
Oh my gosh.
And so it was very unexpected, but I mean, of course, that also plays a part in me being able to embrace the unknown. I mean, it's a terrible, terrible experience, but
yeah,
it has shaped the course of my life.
Did you harbor any resentment or anger about that process and losing him to something that should have been routine?
Of course. I mean, I think I'd be probably inhuman if I didn't.
Sure.
I mean, it's kind of hard to explain because, of course, I had those feelings, but life moves on so quickly that you kind of just have to...
Whether you like it to or not.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. You just kind of have to accept it for what it is, which is not comfortable.
Yeah.
But I couldn't change anything. I mean, the one thing I would have wanted... Mm-hmm. was impossible. So,
which is your dad back.
Exactly. Yeah, so there wasn't really any merit in kind of wallowing in that anger or frustration.
Yeah. But that's a very logical thing to say. Mm-hmm. And it's a lot different to actually
apply it,
handle the feelings mm-hmm. and let go.
Mm-hmm.
And do you feel like you were able to do that?
I mean,
do you think it's the difference of, like,
I don't think
saying I can't do anything about mm-hmm. it versus actually letting go and, like, embracing this unchosen path?
For me personally, it's, I've always had things to move on to. Mm-hmm. And around that time, I started developing kind of a faith-based aspect towards life. Mm-hmm. So I still felt like, in a sense, I had my dad there.
Yeah.
It's, you know, more spiritually than physically.
Sure.
But I kind of just decided I was going to stick to that outlook and just, I realized that, you know, if I was going to be happy, then I needed to just move on with that and stick to that.
Yeah. And what about your mom? How did she handle the whole change?
Oh, she's awesome. Loss? Oh, yeah. My mom's a badass. Yeah. I mean, it's just awful overall. And it was extremely painful. And at times it still is, but we're a good team. We just like persevere in a way that moves us forward.
Yeah.
And even at times when it's hard, we just have a mutual agreement that we're going to look to the things that will eventually benefit us. And we're going to move forward spiritually and not with a spirit of anger, because I mean, that's better for you personally. It's just, it just works better.
Yeah.
Even if it's not, even if you could righteously, you know, go back and apply lessons to that person or try to, you know, a lawsuit or whatever, it's just not worth it. You know, life is so short.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad you two had each other through that process.
Me too. Sure
that helps a lot.
It did.
And I have met your mom. She is an amazing woman.
She's incredible.
I'm not going to say it the way you said it, but she is great. Okay. So this was 12 years old, right?
Yes.
Now, that's about seventh grade, am I right? Sixth grade, seventh grade?
Seventh. Grade, yeah, I know it was. It was like seventh.
That. Seventh grade. Okay. Now, moving forward, you had a few years that this was kind of behind you. Maybe it's never behind you, but at least you had started moving forward with your life.
Time-wise, it was getting more and more behind
me. Yeah, time had passed. We should say that's a better way to say it. Maybe some time had passed, and you started having some health issues of your own.
Yeah,
can you go back to just the very beginning and kind of walk us through how you started to manifest these problems?
Absolutely.
Or what was going on inside of you?
So when I was, I believe I was 14, I grew up on a ranch in Ojai, and we decided to move to a place called Westlake Village. Mm-hmm. And I decided to attend a school called Oaks Christian. It's why we actually moved to Westlake, because I saw that school from the side of the freeway and I was like, oh, I want to go there.
Yeah.
It just has this, I really had no, you know, I didn't know anybody there. I just thought, wow, that looks like a cool place and I want to go there. And so we moved to Westlake in 2014, and I started school there. And I'd say it was about somewhere in eighth grade, maybe the beginning of ninth, that I started kind of experiencing the beginnings of a body that was slowly but surely getting more tired. And
when you say the beginnings, what were the sort of early symptoms that you were having?
It kind of just started with lethargy. Like nothing super alarming.
Okay.
And then it first started mainly with my digestion.
Yeah.
I slowly became less and less able to digest properly. So, I mean, honestly, it would just manifest as bloating. Yeah. By the time I got to my senior year, every time like a morsel of food would hit my stomach, I would bloat to like 3 months pregnant. It was insane.
Wow.
It impaired my breathing. But that wasn't originally how it was like. It was pretty... it was pretty minimal, which is probably why it took me so long to act on it or talk about it.
Yeah.
Because it was, you know, it's kind of like the frog boiling in water metaphor.
Yeah.
You know, you don't realize that you're suffering until you're gone.
It becomes normal as it's just slowly
habituation.
Getting worse, right?
Yeah, for sure. And so it started with digestion for sure. And then lethargy. I just found myself being so tired, but I was so passionate about life that I just, you know, kept going full steam ahead because, you know, the heart side of me, it's like, oh, I love life.
I can't just stop living. I'm going to keep doing
exactly
things, right.
And so mainly started with lethargy and digestion. And in my ninth grade year, I was having so much fun. I filmed Beautifully Broken during that time. And that took me to film in Louisiana and South Africa. And it's such a, you know, it's a story about the Rwandan genocide and sexual abuse. It's a true story of three families who ended up healing each other through their different trials and tribulations throughout life. And I was just passionate about life. Like I was doing that. I was doing school.
Mm-hmm.
It was just, I was stoked. And so life was good, but almost so good that I didn't realize that my body wasn't quite in sync with that level of goodness. And so it started with digestion and lethargy. I got to my sophomore year and it was even more lethargy, worse digestion. And I started feeling a little bit nauseous. I started having chills all the time. That was the weird thing. Like I was always cold.
Yeah.
And, but they still weren't any symptoms where you're like, oh, let's take her to the hospital. Oh right, my gosh, right. This is a big deal.
It's kinda like, you know, what's going on with you?
Exactly. Right? And, I was kind of getting paler all the time, which is not a typically a big deal. Like, you know, paleness is not, a scary thing.
Yeah, it's a symptom that kind of points maybe to there being something wrong there though, right?
Exactly.
And so this is eighth grade now, ninth grade.
And then 10th grade and then 11th grade, I'd say is when it started peaking in a way that I couldn't deny it because...
So how did that manifest?
My heart rate was just, I could feel like my heart pounding all the time. I could never...
Beating out of your chest.
Exactly. And wow. I was sweating profusely.
And
my
chills
hands.
Too?
Yes. Wow. So my hands were always sweating. My feet were always sweating. I always had chills. And then what started happening is my extremities started turning purple and blue at random times.
No, I got to imagine that, like, I'm just trying to put myself in your shoes thinking about this from a standpoint of, you know, sort of overlooking the lethargy along the way and, you know, thinking the chills are sort of weird and then starting to have, you know, purple hands and like sweating and like, this sounds like it's starting to get bad enough that you were probably worried or scared or...
I wasn't. Like, I just was kind of one of those things that you kind of always think you're invincible until you're not. Mm-hmm. And I'd never faced any health issues of my own. Really. So I just kept thinking, I don't know how I did it, but I just kept somehow falling into this trap of not noticing it almost.
So you were going to school still full time. Were you missing school?
No,
at all?
I would periodically get bronchitis and that caused me to miss school. But now that makes more sense. But then it nothing seemed to correlate. And then everything just started spiraling out of control, really, though, the beginning of my senior year. And digestion just wasn't working at all, pretty much. I was always nauseous, always cold. My extremities were just like, they were pretty discolored at a lot of times.
And I'm imagining you weren't eating very much at this point.
No, I wasn't. And
so you're pretty small even now when you're starting to come back to health. Like, what are we talking about as far as your weight fluctuation or loss?
Around then, I was maintaining at about 100 pounds. I'm 5'1½", give or take. And
we'll give you the half.
Oh, great. Yeah. Thanks. And so it's weird. I wasn't losing as much weight as I would have expected. And I don't know why. That didn't start till a few months later. But at that time, it started getting to the point where it was like hard for me to stand up. Every time I'd stand up, I call it HBO vision. I would look and everything would be staticky. And I would get dizzy. And all these symptoms that affected all systems, none of them seemed to correlate. Like there's not a common thread that you would normally know about that would connect all of those.
Right.
And so... Junior year, I took an AP Psych class. And I remember very clearly, I wasn't originally going to take that AP Psych class because I was talking with my counselor and I remember he advised me, he said, you should take AP Psych. And I said, why? Like, I don't have any, I want to be, you know, at that point I wanted to be a biomedical engineer. And I just thought AP Psych, it didn't seem like something I would want to do or needed to do. Okay. So I was kind of confused by that. But
so how does AP Psych fit into this story?
Yeah. So AP Psych is definitely something I feel like God placed in my life as a necessity. It has, without that course, I don't think I would be here. So in that course, which I didn't know you learned about this in AP Psych, but you learn about something called the peripheral nervous system, also known as the autonomic nervous system. It's not the central nervous system. It's the side that controls all involuntary functions. So anything from, you know,
like
heart rate,
digestion, flow.
Heart rate, blood flow, you know, constriction.
Sweating.
Mm-hmm. Constriction of blood vessels. Just any process you don't have to think about to do. That's that system.
And it's interesting you're bringing this up because these sound like all the systems that were starting to go haywire for you.
So, and I still wasn't quite aware enough to realize that. So my senior year, well, let me go back to AP Psych. In AP Psych, you specifically learn about the parasympathetic nervous system and the sympathetic. The parasympathetic nervous system is responsible for rest and digest. So it's the side of the system that, you know, calms your heart rate. It allows you to sleep. It is responsible for digestion. It just, you know, those nerves control the muscles that contract and allow food to properly go through your body. Mm-hmm. And then the sympathetic nervous system is known as the fight or flight system. So it's a system that comes into play when you're in a situation of do or die. And right, so pretty much that system shuts off digestion and triggers, you know, a fast heart rate. It triggers sweating and just a bunch of things that would be necessary if you were fleeing a crazy situation.
Right. So, now your body does this essentially to conserve energy so that it can divert calories and resources to like your big muscles for running and things like that. That's the basic idea of what you're describing.
Yeah, it's very evolutionary. So, in the weird thing about these systems is when one is on, the other is typically off or at a very low, low activity.
Right.
And which the learning this stuff in class, I was fascinated by it. I mean, AP Psych was the highest grade I had ever gotten in any class, and it was just something that came super naturally to me. And I don't know why. It just was something I was fascinated by. I didn't really have a reason.
Well, you found one later.
Yeah. And so the next year, when my symptoms, beginning of senior year, got super bad to the point where it was just like getting hard to stand up. I couldn't eat, getting hard to sleep. Everything I did was a task. And my heart rate was just like, I didn't know how to describe it, but it felt like my heart was going to beat out of my chest.
Wow.
At any given moment. And
so you were in fight or flight kind of. Continuously.
And so
your body's probably coursing with cortisol the whole time.
Yeah. And so it's kind of this weird thing where you just feel like you can't turn off your body, which is the weirdest thing to say. I wouldn't have understood that if I wasn't going through it.
Right.
But truly,
can you try to describe that for the listeners, like what it actually feels like to not be able to turn your body off? I know it might be difficult.
It feels like, you know, that feeling you get when something bad is about to happen. Like
a dread kind of like, creeping
let's say
up
you're,
on you.
Let's say you're walking, more of a shock.
Like, I can't walk.
Okay.
Strolling.
Let's say you're going somewhere and there's a car or a bike that's about to hit you.
Right.
And you don't know it. And then all of a sudden you see it and you're like, oh my gosh, I gotta make a move. And so that's
like
that
a mix of terror and adrenaline and fear and
you all of a sudden
excitement almost that you have to do something.
Yeah.
Right
you
away.
All of a sudden have that pit in your, in your stomach. That's like, oh my gosh, everything goes almost silent in your body. It felt like I was in that state all the time.
Oh my goodness.
It felt like something terrible was like my body was preparing to brace for something terrible always.
Yeah.
Only now do I know how to describe that.
Right.
Because I know what it feels like to not be in that state. But it just felt like, you know, I was always running a marathon or always getting ready to run a marathon. It was exhausting. It became really hard to focus. And just slowly it got to the point where I was completely unable to perform like basic tasks.
Okay. So we've gotten now to your senior year.
Yes.
And in your senior year, things are starting to get really bad.
Yes.
Right. You're suffering to the point where it's clear that there's something definitely wrong with you.
Yes. And
you had endured sort of a long, slow progression of this just getting worse and worse. And now it's at the point where it's unbearable, give or take.
Absolutely. It was, because every time I'd eat, it would impair my breathing. Like I couldn't breathe out or get enough air in.
Right.
And I started getting hives down my legs, which was really weird. But we went to a gastroenterologist because that's what you do when you have stomach issues.
Right.
And so he didn't quite, you know, on first glance, he didn't exactly know what was going on. And so we ended up running a CT scan and that showed I had
I seem to remember there's more to that part of the story. You asked for the CT scan.
Yes, I asked for the CT scan.
What made you ask for that, or where did you come up? Why was it you that was asking for a CT scan?
You know, I'm not quite sure. I remember waking up just one morning, and I just felt like it was on my heart. So I don't know if it's some sort of spiritual intervention, or if it's just an instinctual side of me growing up in the medical field. I knew that that was a scan that maybe would show something.
Mm-hmm.
And so we ran the scan, and then the next day he called and he said, "You have a compressed celiac artery." And I was like, "What's a compressed what?" "What's that?" And he said, "You know, there's this artery branching off of your aorta. It's called the celiac artery.
Mm-hmm.
It supplies blood to, you know, small bowel, colon, wherever. It's you know, it's mainly a digestive artery."
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, "Oh, okay. That sounds like the issue." And he said, "Yeah, it's the issue, it seems, for all of this, all your symptoms. You're going to need to have open surgery to release
heart
it."
Heart surgery, you're just saying, right?
I mean,
open chest surgery.
It's not really like your chest. It's more like, I'd say it's closer to your stomach.
Okay. Okay.
Because for me, it's like right below, it's like right in between my ribs.
So this was still a very invasive surgery.
Yes, it's
right?
Pretty. It's really invasive.
If I remember correctly, you have a pretty awesome scar.
Yes.
Left over, right?
Scars are the best.
Yeah, I agree. So you had this battle wound now because you went in and you got an open something kind of surgery.
Yeah,
right?
And so I was, you know, we found a surgeon that was an expert in this, and he did the surgery.
Okay.
And it was on my aorta. He freed the artery, and about pretty much a day after surgery, I could tell it worked. My digestion came back. My blood stopped pooling at my extremities. I stopped having chills. My heart palpitations, they were nowhere. It was weird.
Yeah.
It was like my whole life was turned around.
So at this point, the medical establishment has really helped you get to a place where something seems to be getting better in this condition that had just been getting worse and worse. Okay. So you had some hope here. Things were feeling good. How's this progressed from there?
So for 3 months, I lived my life. It was incredible. I was on cloud, you know. Cloud 11.
Oh, and two above cloud 9. That's impressive. Okay.
Cloud 11, cloud 12.
It's like you had a new lease on life.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, I was on like cloud 1,000.
I don't think we can count that high on this in an hour show. So we're
just
gonna move on.
But it was incredible. I just resumed. I lived life like I never had before. I didn't realize I was suffering so much. And all of a sudden, have all these things taken away, all my symptoms taken away.
So it were the frog in the slowly heating up water that just got put in a nice cool bath.
Yes. It was amazing.
Wow. Okay.
And, you know, my surgeon had said, you know, you might need bypass because your artery was so compressed by this thing called the median arcuate ligament. He said, you know, later on it might collapse because it was so weak. And so we knew that going in, but it wasn't expected.
Yeah.
And so we got to the 3 month mark, and all of a sudden within a week, my symptoms came back, all of them.
Like, so this wasn't a slow progression over years anymore at all.
No, it was immediate, pretty.
Okay.
I mean, I had 3 months, and then within a week, it was like everything I had gained was taken away all of a sudden.
And what was your mental state at this point? I mean, having all of this like new lease on life for 3 whole months and feeling like there's a lot of hope now and things are better, and then just to have it sort of whisked out from like the rug pulled out from under you so quickly. What was your mental space at that point?
I was really, really upset, but I also thought, oh, I just need bypass surgery and I'll go back which to most people that would seem like bypass surgery. That's a huge deal. And it is a huge deal. But if you think on the grand scheme of things,
you're dying, it's like anything is better than that.
Yeah. Right? If you have something that can fix you, then that's it. I mean, it's just a miracle.
Yeah.
And so
you assumed when these things started to back up.
Yeah, I just thought, oh, I guess my blood flow.
You just have to do the surgery or something would be doable because they had fixed it before.
Exactly.
Okay.
And I thought, you know, I'll just fly back and get bypass. Yeah. And my mom, you know, she had the same outlook. We'll just go back. We'll see him and we'll get this done. We'll get this behind us.
And so how did that work out?
So I go back. I went to see him. He ran an ultrasound to check the velocity in the artery, and it was normal. It hadn't collapsed.
So is that good news?
No, it was, I mean, it would have been better to hear, oh, it collapsed. That's the reason why.
Okay.
Because answer is better than no answer.
Because this thing showed that your artery was working correctly, that meant that the hope of what you thought was going to be able to help mm-hmm. you was now taken away.
And so, you know, he looked at me and he said, your artery's fine. It can't be this issue. And I remember I asked him if he had somehow treated the nerves on the artery and if that could have been the source of the issues. And he said, no, it's not the nerves. And he said, you know, I think you need to just ride this out. And I was like, at this time, I can't. Yeah, I've lost all like functioning in my life. Like I can't even carry out, you know, a daily schedule.
Sort of like someone telling you to ride it out as you're being drugged by a train or something. Exactly. Right?
Just live with it.
And, yeah.
You know, and to see if, I don't know if he meant to see if it goes away or to see if I can, you know.
Yeah.
Somehow deal with it better. But those were crazy words, because to hear it from the person who had fixed me to then hear him say he had no idea. I mean, that's terrifying.
I'm sure as well, because you're hurting and he's the one that's supposed to have some hope, right? You had gone there kind of hoping mm-hmm. that this would be your answer.
Yes. And so I asked him if he knew anybody who could, you know, guide us, and he didn't. Like, there was just, it was kind of just a dead end. Okay. And so we came back home.
So what happened next? Where did you go from there? Where does a young high school girl who feels like she's dying, that already had open chest surgery, where does she go next?
I remember my mom and I, we flew home and we really had no idea what to do.
Yeah.
And, you know, at this point I had seen quite a few doctors. I think it was on like maybe my sixth doctor or something.
Okay.
For this issue.
Yeah.
And I mean, this is my only issue, but I mean,
we all have issues.
We all have issues.
Let's not sell you short.
Medically speaking, this was my only issue. And so we came back and we had no idea what to do. And so I was on one of the support groups for median arcuate ligament syndrome. And I heard that, you know, maybe this was a neurogenic issue instead of a blood flow issue. And at this point, I hadn't connected the dots of what was actually going on. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is like, you know, this isn't really...
Well, no one expected you to connect the dots.
No.
And you're a high school kid. Mm-hmm.
And so I saw that there was a surgeon on Facebook who was world-renowned. He was, you know, across the country. And he believed Mal's median arcuate ligament syndrome was a neurogenic issue. And so we just decided, okay, we have to go see him. And so went to see him and I told him all my symptoms, and he said, you know, I could maybe perform another operation, but it will only take away your pain. I can't take away your symptoms. And I was like, you know, mm-hmm. that's not enough. I have extreme pain, but that's not it.
Yeah.
I mean, I couldn't just live without pain. There's so much more. And so he did a trial nerve block to test that plexus to see how the celiac plexus, which is the nerve bundle on the celiac artery that was freed mm-hmm. in my surgery. Mm-hmm. And he tested it and my symptoms like didn't really work, but my symptoms went away for like a second. Like mainly only my digestive symptoms for a second.
So maybe you had a breadcrumb come out of that, but
a breadcrumb, exactly.
no actual meal came from it.
No relief. And it goes away very...
No ability to eat a meal, I should say.
And it went away very quickly because it was just a trial nerve block. Mm-hmm. So it was just done with lidocaine, which is short-lasting, you know, it's a short-lasting anesthetic. And it went away, but all of a sudden, I started thinking, I was like, this vaguely mimics what happened after my surgery. And so...
So you felt a familiar sensation, but not to the same degree of relief.
No, not at all. Right. But I just thought, something was done in the surgery to my nerves. I know my surgeon said he didn't, but maybe the anesthesiologist did. And I told my mom, because things were moving so fast, we hadn't gotten my medical records yet. And mm-hmm. I said, we got to get my medical records. There's something in there that will point to all of this.
Now, I've seen medical records before. They're like cryptic.
Right. They are, yeah. And I didn't even have the full report. I called the hospital because at the time I was 18. So, of course, my mom would have, but they don't want to talk to my mom. They want to talk to me because I'm an adult.
Yeah, yeah.
And so they told me, they said, we're going to have to FedEx your medical records, but that's going to take, you know, a week or two. And I said, I don't have a week or two to wait on medical records. And they said, oh, well, you can go in my health chart and you can see all the chemicals used there and compounds and... try to figure it out yourself. Why? Because it wasn't the report. It was literally just all like 200
just a list
chemical substances put into my body from the time I had the surgery to my stay in the hospital, which I think was 3 days total, which isn't that long, but it's surprising how much is given to you during those, you know, 72 hours.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, they marked everything from a saline bag to a blood thinner. And so I started going through the medical records. And somewhere in going through them, I realized that AP psychology really applied to this issue. And I thought, oh, okay, my heart rate's up. That correlates to sympathetic activity. I'm sweating. That correlates to sympathetic activity. I don't digest. That correlates to sympathetic activity because it shuts off the parasympathetic, which does digest. And I pretty much connected all my symptoms to what I had learned in AP psychology. And then I thought of this one chart that my teacher, Mr. Allen, showed me in class. And it was this chart that detailed where the sympathetic nervous system lies and versus where the parasympathetic lies. The parasympathetic is more like at the base of the spinal cord and it's near the top and bottom of the spine, but it's mainly not in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
But the sympathetic is. And so I realized from that one chart, my celiac plexus is a sympathetic nerve bundle. And so I just kind of formed this hypothesis of something in my surgery numbed that plexus, and that's what fixed me for 3 months. And So
let me see if I get this straight here. You got your own abbreviated medical records,
mm-hmm.
started looking through them and thinking like, I got to do something because no one else is.
Yeah, nobody was.
And you came up with a hypothesis using some information you had learned in AP Psych about what all these different symptoms were tying into.
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
It kind of came from a place of, you know, desperateness because at this point I was even sicker than I was the first time.
Wow. Yeah.
And so, because even the surgeon I had just seen couldn't explain my symptoms. I asked him if he knew anybody he could refer me to and he said no. And
so you had seen every doctor you had been referred to.
So, yes, and there are even more.
To multiple places around the country trying to get seen and helped and fixed, yes. Right?
And so I started looking through the medical records, and I saw in one slot it said 20 milliliters of 1.3% bupivacaine. And I thought to myself, I wouldn't know what bupivacaine is unless I had grown up in a medical household, which I had. And so I knew lidocaine, bupivacaine, like I just knew common knowledge that was a numbing, you know, substance.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so I thought to myself, I was like, where was that put? And I knew for my AP chemistry class that 1.3% was a relatively high concentration. So it was going to be really potent.
Mm-hmm.
Because in AP chem, we mainly use 0.25%, 0.5%. So 1.3% was going to be powerful. And so I just thought to myself, maybe my anesthesiologist put something on my nerves in hopes of helping my pain, but didn't realize that they actually numbed my sympathetic nervous system.
Yeah.
Because in the sympathetic nervous system, it's a bidirectional pathway. So messages going to and from the brain are all right there, going up and down. And so I just thought if you put a block there, you're blocking a whole, you know, system. And
yeah, a whole range of communication.
Exactly.
And symptoms there, yeah.
And so I started, you know, I had my medical records and I had this hypothesis and I started just taking it. I still had a lot of doctors we were just going to see. And so
I remember in the pre-interview, you also talked about the dose itself.
Mm-hmm.
So was the dose like a strange amount besides the percentage of it?
I mean, 20 milliliters was relatively a lot, you know, speaking in terms of that substance.
Yeah.
And so I just knew that that dosage was, it's pretty much as high an amount of numbing, of a numbing chemical you can put anywhere. I mean, it's the highest grade anesthetic.
Yeah.
And so I just started running with it. I just started developing this weird, wacky AP psych high school based hypothesis that, okay.
So you took a little bit of chemistry, a little bit of psychology, maybe a little bit of math from what you learned in high school.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And you created your own hypothesis.
Yes.
Okay. So now.
Because nobody else was. Everybody was just telling me, you know, there's nothing, deal with it.
You'll be fine, and figure it out or something.
Exactly. And so
where did you take this hypothesis first?
Well, so my hypothesis was that my surgery worked because my surgeon or my anesthesiologist somehow numbed my sympathetic nervous system. And really the real issue was underneath that. Something is attacking my sympathetic nervous system. And they somehow blocked that system and stopped that, you know, that sympathetic nervous system under fire attack.
Yeah. And did you actually have something wrong with your artery? I mean, was that surgery also necessary along the way?
It was. Okay. I mean, it gets really trippy. It's kind of like CSI.
Yeah.
But so I started going and seeing all these doctors. And one doctor, I proposed my hypothesis. And I said, you know, is there somebody you can take, like, refer me to a neurogastro person or somebody who knows these nerves? And he said, there's just no money in that field. Said there's no big pharma behind it. Nobody knows anything about it. And I just, you know, he was being honest and it was real. And he was right, actually. There's not a lot of money in it.
Yeah.
And there are very few people who can shed any insight on that specific area of the body.
So the specialists you'd been seeing really didn't know how to make sense of your symptoms or your hypothesis.
No. And so then I saw another doctor. I told him my hypothesis. I said something was attacking my sympathetic nervous system. The surgery worked because, you know, it blocked that out. And then, you know, it lasted 3 months. And then another weird thing that happened is I looked up theoretically how long 20 milliliters of 1.3% bupivacaine would last. And it said literally 3 months. Exactly 3 months.
Wow. Which was basically the exact amount of time that you had relief.
Yeah. So it was to the day almost.
So this, I mean, you sound like a private, or like a detective here who's unearthing a case, but this was your body and your case that you were unearthing.
Yeah, it was.
So this was very urgent for you from the standpoint of actually living it while you're trying to solve it.
Yes.
And you had spoken to some of these specialists who just didn't know what to do with your hypothesis or how to help you.
They didn't know. And then I came across one doctor who was a gastroenterologist and I told him my hypothesis from high school. And he said, you know, that actually makes sense. And he said, you know, let's go down that pathway. Let's try some medications that might work on your nerves and let's get you tested for some, you know, autonomic symptoms. And I was like, finally, somebody who understands that it's a problem with my autonomic nervous system and something's attacking it. And he was my 11th doctor.
Oh my gosh. So
I had gone to see him and then the next week I went to go see him again because we were just, you know, desperately trying to get answers.
Yeah, at your wit's end.
Because at this point I had dropped down to 95 pounds. I had originally started at about like 103 and 104 and then dropped down to 95. And I was losing a pound a day and things were just getting so bad. I dropped out of my senior year of high school.
Wow.
I quit everything. I had no activities. Like my activities included lying in bed and trying to eat something. I didn't do anything.
Yeah.
And then I would just research. It was me and my computer.
So you went and saw this doctor who entertained your idea.
Yes.
And then what did he do from there?
I went to see him the second time and somehow it seemed as though somebody, one of my prior doctors, had talked to him, and all of a sudden he just didn't. He told me, he said, you know, I think your surgery, he's listed a few things, and then he said, I think your surgery could have been a placebo. And I knew from AP Psych how serious the word placebo is. I mean,
right.
The definition of placebo is it worked because you believed it, or it didn't work because you didn't believe it.
Yeah.
And so he was pretty much saying, I got fixed the first time. I stopped the pooling of blood in my extremities, and I stopped my bloating, and I stopped my heart palpitations because I believed the surgery worked. And that was such a huge change from the first time I met him that I don't know what happened. And then I told him, I said, but I know what happened to my body. And he said, but you don't.
Sounds like he talked to his lawyer and decided. Yeah.
And I just sat there thinking, how do you deal with that? Like, yeah. You can't.
And it must be so crushing to be like a high school age student who is talking to this doctor with a big desk and a white coat.
Yeah.
And even an authority figure in a lot of ways, but also, you know, somewhat resembling your dad.
Yeah.
Right? So there's a higher level of like maybe a perception of authority there. And it must have been pretty crushing for you to be.
It's very different because growing up with my dad, it's like everybody took him so seriously. And therefore, in a weird way, took me seriously.
Yeah.
Even as a young kid, they just respected me. And then to be in this situation where I didn't have that.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to call it clout, but it kind of is.
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't have that, you know, credibility because I was just a high school student.
Yeah. With
my mom, and we weren't, you know, we didn't have that same.
Yeah.
We didn't have that, you know, label. We couldn't label ourselves like that. And so we weren't taken seriously.
Now, I hate to rush the rest of this story. Mm-hmm. We have less than 10 minutes left.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. I'll speech right now.
No, but I want to hear where this went and what happened. So
what happened is he wasn't going to work. So I had been online one night and I had looked up clinical trials, and I saw, and on one of the clinical trials I looked up, it said celiac plexus block fixes gastroparesis. Or no, it didn't even say it fixed. It said somebody was attempting to, you know,
to treat,
to see if there was a correlation there.
Yeah.
And it said Dr. Linda Wynn, and she was at Stanford. And I told my mom, I was like, Mom, we gotta get to this person. I think they're gonna understand what's going on. And, you know, I had my hypothesis ready, and I had it ready to be rejected because it had been.
Because that's what you were expecting at this point. Yeah.
And then I remember I got to her office, and I said, I think this thing given to me in my surgery. Oh, another thing that had happened is I had emailed my surgeon, or I'd called my anesthesiologist asking, where did you place this 20 milliliters of 1.3% bupivacaine? And he said, I didn't, your surgeon did. And I was like, what? And so I emailed my surgeon, and they got back with me, and his PA said, yeah, we put that right on your celiac plexus in hopes it would ease your pain. And I said, you blocked my whole sympathetic nervous system. And he said, no, we didn't. That's impossible. That wouldn't have happened. And so it just kept getting slammed. And I told them, I was like, I'm so thankful you guys did this, because without that, we wouldn't have any leads.
Right.
And so I went to see Dr. Wynn, told her my hypothesis. And she said, that makes 100% sense.
Oh, Emily, tell me, what were you feeling like the moment you explained this hypothesis for maybe the third or fourth or fifth time to a doctor?
I wasn't quite set because we still didn't have a solution.
Mm-hmm.
But
were you validated in that, at least in that moment, like just hearing someone agree with you that there was something happening?
It was amazing.
Yeah.
And she said, I'm going to send you for an autonomic workup at the Stanford Neurology Clinic. And within a week, I was getting tested for dysautonomia, and just my whole peripheral nervous system was being looked into. And the head neurologist in autonomics there is Dr. Safwan Girade. And I was being tested, and he came in, and he has like a year-long wait list to be seen. And he came in, I was doing this test, a sweat test, and I guess the findings were really abnormal. And so he said, we're doing the consultation now. So like something that would have taken me a year to get in for was rushed in.
So they recognized the urgency of what they were seeing in these.
Yes. And it was the first time it had ever happened. And so for a month, they tried me on medications to see if that could somehow ease the symptoms, and they really didn't. Mm-hmm. And so I came back and I said, can we try this block again? And they said, Okay.
1.3% bupivacaine.
20 milliliters of 1.3% bupivacaine to my celiac plexus.
Yeah.
And so they said, yeah, we'll do it. And so Dr. Nguyen paired me with actually Dr. Friedland, who had done the clinical trial with her that she did on gastroparesis. Okay. He did the block, and within 20 minutes, my symptoms had gone away.
Oh.
Which is bizarre.
Yeah.
And pretty much what it did is it just blocked my sympathetic nervous system and stopped what was attacking it, which we now know is a combination of mast cell dysfunction, which are mast cells are immune cells. They're in the immune system. They mm-hmm. mediate histamines and autoantibodies. And pretty much what was happening is these histamines and autoantibodies were irritating my sympathetic nervous system.
Wow.
And by shutting off the sympathetic nervous system, you actually shut off this neurocellular connection, and these mm-hmm. cells stop attacking the nerves.
Wow. So within 20 minutes, you said?
Yeah, within 20 minutes,
so within I can tell. 20 minutes after you prescribed yourself the treatment that you needed.
Yes.
You had relief, and you could feel maybe at least you were right back to almost where you were after the surgery.
Even better. I mean, there was something about it because I didn't have a scar. It wasn't just sure, cut into. It was right done endoscopically.
You weren't fresh out of surgery.
Yeah. And so it was, even my doctors were shocked by the results because this celiac plexus block has never been used to treat mast cell dysfunction, which for me, I guess from birth, I had a genetic mutation that caused me to have something called Ehlers-Danlos, which has predisposed me to develop mast cell and all these issues.
Wow.
But the block has never been used to treat that. And so we repurposed it. And without the surgery, we wouldn't have ever known that.
Wow. So let me just see if I can recap here. You got deathly ill. You went to every doctor that you could get referred to. You got no help. You finally found through scouring the internet and medical journals that you had access to, you found a trail of breadcrumbs that seemed to describe what you were looking at. And then you came to Stanford and told these world-renowned Stanford doctors what you thought was wrong, and they agreed with you, and then did the treatment that you prescribed to yourself.
And it worked.
And it worked. And yes. And it's safe to say it maybe saved your life, right?
It did save my life, 100%. Yeah. And now they have, I can just keep getting those, and they use specific medications mm-hmm. to hopefully prolong that.
Yeah.
And we're just onto it, and we have it under control. And I mean, it's something I have to live with, but the whole thing is I can live with it.
But now
I mean,
you have a way to manage it, right?
Exactly.
And the color is back in your face.
Yes.
And you've gained some weight again, and you're being active.
About 10 pounds.
Living life again in a way that feels satisfying and enriching.
Yes.
And what's next for you?
Oh, wow. I mean, I just want to help other people who have this. Like, nobody's talking about it.
Do you have any idea how many people are afflicted with this same type of condition?
People have different things that are caused by this thing, and they don't even know it.
Wow.
Most people don't get diagnosed, and by the time they do, there's irreparable damage to their autonomic nervous system.
Oh, my
gosh.
And
it can't be repaired. And so, without my surgery, the normal time to be diagnosed is 10 years. And for me, it was still under a year because I had that surgery, which seemed like a red herring, but it was a necessary red herring.
Yeah. Yeah. So you are feeling very passionate now about actually helping get this word out, which is partly why you're on the show here today.
Yes.
And what else are you going to be doing? I hear you have a pretty prestigious offer now that you've
I'm just going to research with my doctors, a multitude of things, and maybe some other doctors that they know as well, just on this issue of mast cell and EDS, and just what's actually what are the correlating factors? Nobody really knows a lot about it,
right?
But they know it's there.
Well, you have a very deep and personal connection to this condition, and I can't think of anyone more well-suited to be able to start being in that space and working to help other people.
Thank you.
Get through maybe, hopefully not as severe as your condition, but...
I mean, some people are more severe. It's insane. Yeah. This illness is a beast.
Well, I know it's hard to believe, but it's already been just about the hour. Emily, I am so grateful for you coming on the show today.
Thank you.
I'm so happy that you have found some relief and some direction how you can help make good for a lot of other people through your experience as well.
Thank you.
And you are an amazing young woman.
Oh, thank you, Ben.
So, no, thank you.
And you're awesome.
And thank you again for coming on the show. And hopefully, those of you listening, if you appreciated Emily's story, you can certainly reach out and I can forward messages on to her if you would like. And thank you for tuning in to Modern Education. We are here every Friday. I guess I should say goodbye to Emily. Goodbye, Emily. I'm going to take you off the air. Thank you again for coming. And we hopefully will have you back to hear how your research has been going.
Oh, that'd be great. Thank you.
And this has been Modern Education. We're here Fridays from 3 to 4 p.m. for your commute home. Every Friday, we usually bring you a live show or a live taped pre-recorded show from a previously aired or recorded program. So if you are interested in Modern Education, please check us out on the web at Modern Education on Facebook, Modern Education on KZSU on the Instagram. You can also look up my website, mrwoodford.com. And we always love to hear from our audience. So you can always call into the studio, 855-723-9010. And we would love to hear from you. You can text us also on the Twitter at KZSU or at KZSUDJ. And I am, again, Ben Woodford, the host of Modern Education. Thank you for tuning in. Come back next week for more.